Okay, Trisha and Kris here. Thanks for being with us today.
Yes, good
morning. We've had to move our set because these days have been so windy it's blowing our hair around.
Well, yes, it is a windy hair day.
Looks like you're riding a motorcycle facing right into the wind.
Hairspray does not even help today.
But this is good. We can sit down here and open up our Bibles.
Right.
Proverbs 31, woman. If mama ain't happy, ain't nobody happy. Yesterday we looked at all her children are clothed in scarlet. I love that. Because I picture that not only that her kids, her children, why do I say kids? Kids are what goats have.
Oh, yes, that's true.
So we say train up a child in the way he should go. We always talk about our kids. They're not kids. And you don't raise kids. You raise soybeans and you raise pigs.
Right.
You train up a child. There's training involved,
okay?
So where are we at? Verse 21, she's not afraid of snow for her household. Mm-hmm. All her house is clothed in scarlet. Mm-hmm. And then verse 22, I want you to read that. This is really interesting to me, and something really leaped off when I was studying that today.
She makes tapestry for herself. Her clothing is fine linen and purple.
Okay, she makes tapestry.
Tapestry, yes.
Now, tapestry is not only clothing. We're dealing with her curtains, her drapes, whatever's draped over the back of the couch.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, she's decorated the home and she has beautiful things set up and it's inviting.
Yes.
One thing people say in our house of fire is they love that our house is so warm and inviting. That means more to me probably than anything else. But notice that she makes for herself tapestry. Verse 11, the heart of her husband safely trusts in her. First of all, she's talking about her husband.
Mm-hmm.
Then it says all her household. She's talking about her house.
Right.
So she reaches out for her husband.
Mm-hmm.
She makes things for her house.
Right.
Now, and this is something that maybe people don't see when they're reading through this. She makes tapestry for herself.
Right.
Her husband, her household, herself.
Right.
She put herself last willingly. I don't know if the scripture, the way that it's worded in that direction, is saying that she should be last. I don't think she should be last. If mom ain't happy, ain't nobody happy. She should be made happy. But she's willingly put herself there in that position and makes tapestries for herself. What I want you to see today is there are some women that do nothing for themselves.
Right.
They have become so selfless that it's like they don't even have a self.
That's true.
That's a tragic thing.
It is a tragic thing. But, you know, I think as women and mothers, I mean, it's usually within us to take care of our husbands first and our household and our children and then ourselves. And sometimes we don't get to that day to take care of ourselves. And it's very important that we do get to those days and that we set aside those days to take care of ourselves.
I heard a lady conference speaker one time say, we've given so much of the piece of the pie to other people that at the end of the day, there's no pie left and we forgot what kind of pie we were.
Right.
Was I a pecan pie? Was I a lemon pie? Was I a chocolate cream?
Yeah.
You know, once in a while, you have to skim off a little bit for your own self.
Right.
I thought my mom's favorite part of the chicken was a back.
Uh-huh.
Because she always ate backs.
Right.
Well, that obviously then that must have been her favorite piece.
Right.
It wasn't her favorite piece. She likes wishbones, and she likes breast, and she likes a leg.
Right.
But the fact of the matter is, she always served everybody else first, and herself was last, so she got what? Back meat.
Right. But I think it is important to put your children and your husband and your home, you know, first, but always schedule time for yourself. If you have to look at the calendar and schedule a day just for a long bubble bath and paint your toenails, that's important to take care of yourself.
I'm hoping to get a lot of likes and a lot of comments today.
Yeah.
Because this is Ladies' Day out. Go take a spa.
Right.
You know, there's a lot of women in this Bible, girls gone wild, I call them. You know, Eve ate us out of house and home. She was prime rib and apple. You think about Lot's wife who became a Saltine statuette. There's Jezebels, all different types of women in the Bible.
Right.
But this is an example of what a woman ought to be, and she shall be praised, it says later in that chapter. Well, don't wait for somebody else to praise you. If you don't get a compliment, compliment yourself. It's time to take a pass to the spa, okay?
Right.
Now, her clothing is fine linen and purple.
Right.
We just read that her kids are in scarlet.
Right.
But fine linen and purple, all of these are symbolism. Scarlet, though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as wool. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be white as snow.
Right.
So scarlet, it talks about our scarlet sins, but we're covered with the scarlet blood of Jesus.
Right.
So First of all, there's redemption in that verse. Right. Her children are clothed in scarlet. Mm-hmm. But now notice this. Where are we at? Verse 22. Mm-hmm. Her clothing, we're not talking about her kids' clothing, her clothing mm-hmm. is fine linen and purple. Solomon is a king. He can afford to dress her that way. But I think all of us husbands need to realize that our wives like to look good, and nothing makes her day like a complete makeover. Right. Fine linen yeah. and purple. Right. Now, the symbolism there, fine linen in Revelation 19, is the righteousness of the saints. Just as her children are clothed with scarlet, she's pleaded the blood over them. She herself is robed in fine linen, white. The righteousness of Christ. She has adapted the very personality of Jesus and taken it, wrapped herself up in it, dressed up in it, and then purple. Purple is the color that kings wear. So these are symbolisms of priesthood. Scarlet, purple, white, the priests wore these colors. So this wife, this model woman, is a priestess in her home. She's praying constantly. She's praying over her children. And she's praying over her husband. I want you to read verse 23, and we'll fit a little bit of this in today, and we'll maybe detail some more tomorrow. Okay.
Her husband is known in the gates when he sits among the elders of the land.
So this is going to talk about the authority of the husband. Here's what I want to close on today, and this might be humorous to you. I don't know if it is. Her husband is known in the gates when he sits among the elders of the land. When he sits. Now, this whole chapter, we've looked at the woman. She's planting a garden. She's running a spindle. She's clothing the children. She's praying for her children. She's buying a field. She's providing food. Wow. There's like ships coming in. Her trunk of her car is full of groceries. Wow. And she's here. She's there. She's like the vineyard. Her fingers are in everything. And then her husband
sits.
And that's all it says about him.
That's what
it doesn't
it
say
says.
One single word except that he sits. So, I like that. I think it's scriptural. I think it's in the Bible for a reason. She's doing all of this. He's sitting on the sofa watching ESPN, and that's the way God has designed us. You can comment if you want.
Well, I think whenever I read this, when he sits among the elders of the land, what that speaks to my heart is that he's a man of authority. You know, Jesus.
We're going to get into that tomorrow, so don't go too far, but go ahead and comment.
You know, Jesus sat down at the right hand of God.
Hallelujah.
And I think that the man is the head of the home. He sits at the gates of the elders, and he's a man of authority. And
we're going to look into that in detail tomorrow. Right. Let me read something right before we close. Psalm 128, we talked about the children around about the table as olive plants. Right. Notice this. Blessed is every man that fears the Lord. Mm-hmm. Starts inside here with a husband or a mom, a dad, whoever it is, the person that's leading that family. Because some of you ladies don't have a husband, and you're in this all by yourself. Right. God will anoint you to be the headship. Look at this. Children, or happy shall your wife be. So it starts with the man, he's in connection with God. Then the wife, the couple. And then children like olive plants. It always starts in a person's heart. Then in the marriage. Then in the family. Now notice this. Behold, thus is the man will be blessed who fears the Lord. The Lord bless you out of Zion. We talk about Zion, that's a picture of the church. So notice this. Starts in dad's heart, then the marriage, then the kids, then the church, Zion. And then you will see the good of Jerusalem all the days of your life. When it affects the church, then it affects the community.
Right.
You get the church right, Branson, Missouri's right.
Yes.
Or Tulsa, Oklahoma, or Los Angeles.
Amen. Mm-hmm.
Then he said, yes, you may see your children's children. So if I get my heart right, my marriage right, my kids right, my church right, my city becomes right, then it passes on generationally.
Yes, it does.
And my grandkids are right.
Yes.
You can affect the future of a nation by listening to this Proverbs 31 series.
Yes.
And then notice this statement. Yes, your children's children and peace be upon Israel. Israel is the nation. So this pattern that God's given us in Proverbs 31, we get it right in my heart, my marriage, my home, my church, my city. Pretty soon, the entire nation changes. How can we turn the United States around? It's not by just issuing COVID edicts, and it's not by Republicans are right or the Democrats are right. Here's how you change it. Get dads right. Get marriages right. Get the home right. Get the church right. And if my people, which are called by my name, get it right, then I will heal their land.
That's
praise
right.
God.
Amen.
Thanks for being with us out in the bright Ozark sun today.
Have a happy day.